Okay, we are sitting here with Mr. Bruce Sterling. If you are a science fiction fan, you should have definitely heard about his work. He is one of the best known science fiction authors in the same class like, for example, William Gibson. I'm not some kind of person who reads science fiction, but I also heard about him because of the Wired magazine. So we will talk about his work and his views on about technology. Please tell our readers, what do you think about the current trends in technology? Do you think that people use technology too much or underestimate the power of the technology today? And is the technology helps people to make a better social to make better social life or make people more lonely?
Well, technology is just a word for things invented since I was born. It's actually the old technologies that are dangerous.
The old technologies, like
burning coal.
Yes, yes.
No, that's a really, really dangerous technology. And cars, really dangerous technology. Because they kill a lot more people than computers ever have or probably ever will. So, you know, people tend to overestimate the new ones and underestimate the old ones. But it's really the old ones that are menacing.
Mm-hmm. Yes, and since you are a science fiction author, I believe that you are a big fan of gadget, technology stuff, etc., communication.
Right.
You write about a genre that is called cyberpunk. For people who don't know, what is actually cyberpunk? You are one of those best-known authors for cyberpunk.
Right. Well, you know, in the 80s, my colleagues and I did a lot of speculative writing about computers and computer networks and media and digital media because we knew that someday it would be very important. And, you know, now that day has arrived. In fact, it's completely important. I mean, basically, everything is cyber.
Yes. Siberia, for example.
Yeah.
Yes.
There are games called Siberia.
Yes,
actually.
I know. It is actually quite a good game. Yes.
Not the first time that pun has been made.
Yes.
Yeah. So, you know, the predictions, if you live long enough, predictions of the future will catch up with you and you will find yourself living in the 21st century. So, you know, in the 1980s I did a lot of writing for paper magazines and paper newspapers and, you know, a little bit of work on bulletin board systems. Whereas nowadays it's a common thing for me to do a video podcast for the internet.
Yes.
Which was physically impossible, you know, 10 years ago.
Yes, today it is the hot trend. For example, the next big thing. What do you think about video? Is it overrated today on the internet? I mean, everyone talks about video, juiced, or how do you spell it? I don't know, juiced.
Yeah.
Yes. Everyone talks about video on demand, etc. What do you think about is that trend for combining TV and the internet? And in the 15 years, maybe we won't have TV as we know it. It will be a combination of internet, TV.
I think we already don't have TV as we know it because you know the videotape was just abandoned.
Yes.
You can't go and buy VHS. So. And before that, TV as we knew it, you couldn't even record it and play it back. So, you know, television as a medium has changed many times. And yeah, I think television is in extreme danger from being taken over by wireless broadband. I mean, what you would call internet, I mean, people used to talk about a convergence of media, but I think what you're really seeing is that wireless broadband is eating everything else.
Yes.
It's eating recorded music. It's eating print, newspapers, magazines, television, video. You know, pretty soon it's going to be moving into manufacturing, making physical objects, logistics, and so forth and so on. It's a slow revolution. If you watch it over your lifespan, it's really amazing. I mean, it's just a shocking and impressive and in many ways terrible transformation.
For example, YouTube has more than 100 million videos uploaded.
No, that's just this week's sex bomb. I mean, before video, there was MP3s. You know, before MP3s, there was JPEGs and scanning. And you can just sit there and plot that out on a graph and see, as you know, more and more things are transferred more and more rapidly, they're moved from the analog into the digital. I mean, sure, we're excited about video now. That'll be sexy maybe 3 years, four years.
What is going to be sexy after video? What do you think is the next big thing? Americans like to say the next big thing phrase.
Yeah, I would be thinking geolocativity. Uh-huh. I mean, there's not really a good
Galileo,
term for that.
Galileo, GPS.
Yeah, this kind of, you know, super locative or hyper local kinds of
combination, you know, of Google Maps.
The World Wide Web for the whole wide world.
Yes.
Yeah. A kind of, you know, super internet logistics. That's just it's shipping, it's tracking, it's manufacturing.
Yes. Okay. Yeah. Okay. How long have you been in Serbia? From 2000, I mean.
I started visiting the area about 3 years ago.
Yes. So I believe that you are quite introduced about the IT situation in Serbia. What do you think it is important that Serbia become Cyber Serbia? Can we be the next island, maybe, to be a country where people will have outsourcing jobs for some Western country?
I don't see how you get any choice in the matter. I mean, 10% of your population is in a diaspora, and they're all trying to send money and data home. So, you know, what are you going to do? I mean, you can't impose sanctions at your own borders and try and keep ones and zeros from showing up. It's not very practical. Now, you could try like the Romanian or Belarusian gambit, where you hire the Chinese to come in and sort of impose a wall, you know, around the data of your own country, the sort of great firewall of China. And, you know, that seems to be something that has a lot of popularity among certain states. I mean, you know, there are some Arab states that are into it, places like Tunisia. But every one of those places, with the exception of China, goes broke from trying to do that. It's just not
economically. For example, I think that we have a chance against, for example, Indians, because Serbian people are much better in English language than Indian, and we are in the Eurozone. So it is also of big importance when you communicate with your employer that you don't be in the 10 hours distance, that you can communicate almost in the real time.
Well, you know, I hesitate to come across as a big enthusiast for this, because I really am kind of a student of this kind of transformation. And it's a big, hairy, ambivalent deal. It's not like you get the internet and everything is fine. It's like thinking that you join the Eurozone and everything is
fine.
Yes,
it is not.
I mean,
you join the
Eurozone and some things become very easy, and then other parts become extremely difficult. I mean, you really kind of open yourself up to a lot of influences that, you know, you might or might not enjoy or use anything about. You could go up to, say, Estonia right now.
Yes,
and try and make this same, all right?